Welcome to Norfolk Perspective City Slice. I'm Bob Batcher, and boy, am I blown away with the guests I got. Councilman Paul Riddick. How you doing, sir?
You're really scraping the barrel, Bob.
No. I am so excited to have you on that sofa.
Yeah.
I will be candid with you. I'm not really sure where this 10-minute talk's going to go.
Okay. All right.
Okay.
We'll
Is that cool?
That's fine. Yeah.
You've been on council for a couple of years now.
1992. That's almost 19 years.
Okay.
Right.
And I got it very thought-provoking,
mm-hmm.
very philosophical, with a goal of where you want to go and have your community, have the community, your ward go, right?
Absolutely.
So we're here to talk about the Reverend Green, Joe Green
right.
Lecture Series.
The Joseph N. Green Jr. Lecture Series, which will be, actually, this is the inaugural lecture series. It's something that I'd had in mind for years, bringing different speakers in to Norfolk to share intellectual experiences and just to do things to stimulate the community intellectually. The Attucks Theater, as you know, has been,
awesome.
You know, perfectly renovated. And Joseph N. Green Jr., former city council member, former vice mayor, longtime rector of Grace Episcopal Church, was the guiding force behind the renovation of the mm-hmm. Attucks, which at one time was, I guess you say, it was one of the signposts of the South. And he has been kind enough to lend his name to this series. It'll be called the Joseph N. Green Jr. Lecture Series.
Okay, now, kind enough.
Right.
He's a very humble guy.
Extremely humble, and it's something that I had to nudge him along for several years.
Did you talk to his wife about it?
Didn't get her permission this time, but I'm sure that he got it before
got
he lent his name.
Because they talk about great men having strong
right.
women, and she's one of those.
I'm sure.
But he was an inspiration for many generations.
Absolutely.
And probably generations we haven't met yet either.
Yeah,
right?
Absolutely. He's been a guiding force, and I think he has a lot that we should be proud of as far as his contributions, not only in the religious community, but also as a community activist. You might not think of as an activist, mm-hmm. and as a political leader. He also served on our school board for several years as well.
Wow.
Okay.
So how are you going about picking your speakers?
Well, I tell you, this particular lecture was actually inspired by a lady by the name of Margaret Eads. Margaret Eads is a former editorial writer in the Virginian Pilot. Mm-hmm. Maybe last year, she had an article talking about the problems that black lawyers faced during the civil rights era when they were trying to battle for equality. We were talking about Thurgood Marshall before he became mm-hmm. a Supreme Court Justice, Oliver Hill, Spotswood Robinson. And this particular article, it spoke of how in the 50s, black lawyers were denounced by the General Assembly. They were considered ethically challenged by the Virginia Supreme Court. And so this made me realize what a difficult time black lawyers had back in the day. And so I decided to look at how lawyers from this particular area evolved from not only being lawyers, but so many of them became judges.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we have lawyers from this area such as a woman by the name of Bertha Douglas. Bertha Douglas was the first black woman from Norfolk to be admitted to the Virginia Bar in the 1920s.
Wow.
Then you have Elaine Jones, who was the first black woman to finish the University of Virginia Law School, who went on to lead the NAACP Legal Defense and Education Fund. As far as judges are concerned, Lester Moore Jr. was the first black judge appointed to the bench by the General Assembly in the early 1980s. That was followed by Joseph A. Jordan Jr., who was a former city council member, vice mayor, who was the second judge. Mm-hmm. And we also had John Charles Thomas from Norfolk, strong family, the Sears family, who was the first African-American appointed to the Virginia State Supreme Court by Governor Chuck Robb. And recently, Justice Leroy Hassell from Norfolk, who became Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, African-American, who unfortunately died very prematurely mm-hmm. a few weeks ago. So we have a very rich history in the legal profession, And we decided that this would be the perfect opportunity to highlight that and honor those lawyers who became judges.
Because you touched on something, and what I'm afraid of is in today's world, it's easy to be a lawyer. I mean, you can plug into a law school. You can plug, if you're a good student, you know, I mean, there's things you have to do. And so it's almost you can take it for granted, black, white lawyer, whatever. But you're really describing a time period where there were other challenges.
There were other challenges.
I mean, institutional challenges.
Yeah, institutional challenges. And I don't believe that the bar was as easy for African-Americans back then. Certainly becoming a judge was almost unheard of. As I mentioned, Lester Moore Jr. was appointed in the early 1980s. Well, since then, the General Assembly changed. You have single-member districts. And the way representatives are elected have given African-Americans a better entree to certain things like the judiciary.
Which is the right thing.
Absolutely.
But we can't lose the fact on how these men and women were heroes because of what they had to fight. Okay, I got to figure out how do I switch gears here because we got to sell tickets.
Okay, now. Right? Got to sell tickets. The event, we tried to keep the tickets very low. As I said, it's going to be held on April the 9th at the Attucks Theater. Tickets are $25. They're available at the Scope box office, or you can call Scope at 664-6464, and they have a mechanism that you can, you know, charge them online, or they can be mailed to you for a dollar. And the tickets are on sale now.
Okay.
And so I guess we need to mention again, that's April the 9th at the Attucks Theater, 1010 Church Street. The event begins at 7 p.m. Our speaker will be former Supreme Court Justice, now retired, John Charles Thomas. And it's going to be a wonderful event. And as I mentioned, Bob, the Attucks is going to be our basis right now.
Okay.
But should we need larger venues, we have the Harrison Opera House. We have L. Douglas Wilder Center.
There you go. Yeah.
Some of the future persons, I'm talking about somebody like a John Thompson, former basketball coach at Georgetown University. As a young author by the name of Michelle Alexander, who's written a book called The New Jim Crow, which takes a new and provocative look at the justice system today. We also want to have speakers who will appeal to young audiences as well. And so we're just hoping that this thing will evolve into something that will continue, that will perpetuate itself.
Cool. Now, I think, too, you don't want to go by yourself.
No.
So if you're going down to Scope to get tickets, you might as well get, I don't know, 10, 20 of them?
You just as well, you know. You just as well. We don't have any discounts for blocks or anything like that, but I'm sure if somebody came down, we certainly would make some of us 10 for 200, we'd make some concessions.
When you dreamed up this, who were you hoping to reach as an audience?
As far as the audiences are concerned, we want to have topics that would interest some of the youngest members of our community, some of our seniors. We want to reach, you know, everybody that we can. We really want this to really evolve into something that that we can be proud of. We hope this would be a great intellectual experience for Norfolk.
Now, how often are you going to be having the
I think maybe twice, no more than four times a year. But we would hopefully like to have it at least twice a year.
Okay. Now, I'm assuming that when you've mentioned this idea to others, they said, it can't be done.
Well, believe
it or not. Have
you heard that? Believe it or not, people are excited.
That's cool.
People are excited. A lot of people who are interested in seeing this happen. You know, we have this wonderful theater there that's been renovated.
Oh,
I don't know, can't tell you how many millions of dollars, but it's sitting there and it's docked too many times a week
year. For the people that haven't been there, the other cool part is the addition that was put on.
Yes.
The community rooms net. So I kind of getting ahead of myself here, but I'm thinking that if the conversation gets cooking, it could move over to one of those rooms.
It could. It really could.
Now, in the old days, we would have called that a reception.
Yes.
But, because that's really, you want to get people talking, right?
That's exactly what we want to happen. You know, we really want this to be something that's going to grow.
Okay. You got the sales pitch down, I got to tell you. It's when?
It's April the 9th. It begins at 7 p.m. Tickets are $25. They can be purchased at the Scope box office, or you can call 66464 for further information. You can get them online, or you can have them mailed to you. And they're $25.
And so, and identify, I don't know, 10, 15, 20 of your favorite people and bring them with you.
Bring them with you.
At $25 a head.
Absolutely.
Okay, I'm going to close on a personal note.
Okay.
I still remember KFC with your son, who was about that big, who's now?
He's 6'2". He plays first base for Granby's JV baseball team. He's an eighth grader, getting ready to go to high school.
Man, that's a lot of Kentucky
Fried
Chicken now.
I tell you, you telling me?
Thanks a lot.
Okay,
for
thanks,
everything
Bob.
That you're doing.
Thanks for having me.
Thanks for joining us.
Okay.
Cool song. Man, you got that.